I guess I just want to say a few quick things that we can develop if you want. The first comment I want to make is that the question of Jewish identity, to me, has to be a universal Jewish question. That is to say, it has to be something that can give an account of Jews wherever they are. Yedidia's anxiety that the two great communities in Israel and America could become a yeshut acheret to each other. We know from the study of Jewish history that there have been many times in which communities have experienced each other as yeshut acheret. Sometimes they were symbiotic, sometimes they were competitive, sometimes they didn't have enough to do with each other. But I'm not especially worried about schism just yet. I mean, I have certain worries, but I'm more concerned at arriving at some definition that would encompass all my Jewish brothers and sisters. You know, I raised my son in an Orthodox synagogue, not because I am myself especially Orthodox. I am what the great scholar Harry Wolfson once described as, speaking of himself, as a non-observant Orthodox Jew. But I take him to the Orthodox synagogue for a very simple reason, which is that more of the Jewish tradition is available there than anywhere else. If I wanted to teach him the history of art, and I had to choose between the museum in Akron, Ohio, and the Metropolitan Museum of Art, I would take him to the Metropolitan Museum of Art, because more art is available to him there. That's my primary reason. But I say this because I'm not really interested in the view that Orthodox Judaism or Orthodox Jewry is the future of the Jewish people, because whatever the successes of Orthodoxy are in terms of fertility rates, in terms of day school education, in terms of the transmission of the language, everything I said before is wrong and you should forget it. All of the self-love of the Orthodox doesn't interest me in terms of the conversation we're having. I am not prepared to give up on the 75 or 80% of the Jewish community that is not Orthodox. They are my brothers and sisters, and I have to find some definition, some rubric that can account for them too. Even if, as I say, the Orthodox and the traditionalists have certain obvious strengths, they also have certain less obvious weaknesses, but we're not going to talk about that now. In all the decades in which I have Shehit Labatiti, in which I wrestled, like you, with the question of the definition of Jewishness, there are a few points that became clear to me over time, and I'm going to go through them quickly because I want to get to my larger point now, which we can talk about. For example, it's clear to me that there can be no significant definition of Jewish identity for which religion is not at the center. I don't understand any such definition. I understand alienation from religion. I understand the hatred of religion, but I don't understand indifference to religion as, in some sense, the source, the spring of Jewish identity. Secondly, I've witnessed in America and here an over-politicization of Jewish identity. I do not think that Jewish identity can be primarily political, even though it expresses itself in politics. For the American Jewish community, that means that I cannot regard the American Jewish community primarily as a lobby, even though it has a lobby. In fact, it has two lobbies, v'chein yirbu. But the self-conception of American Jewry cannot be communally and individually as a lobby. Because the community and the individuals have spiritual needs, have cultural needs, have obligations to transmit the tradition that they received, and none of this is accomplished primarily through politics. Too often in Israel, I discover that too many Israelis regard American Jews a little condescendingly, essentially as a lobby. And many American Jews do, by the way, because as I say, politics has become too central in American Jewish identity. Similarly, though I call myself a Zionist, and I am a Zionist, and I can explain what I mean by my Zionism, I don't think that any definition of Zionism can substitute for a definition of Jewish identity. I think that above the term Zionist, the term Israeli Jew, the term American Jew, there is a larger term, which is the term Jew. and that that is still a meaningful term, and that we have to find some conception that would allow us to use the term Jew meaningfully before we break it down into its various subcategories. So Zionism, for all its urgency and necessity and justification, and we can talk about this for a long time, and in America we probably need to, maybe you need to here also, still that, for me, is yet another case of an inadequately political conception of Jewish identity. The third thing that's clear to me from my experience as an American Jew is what is certainly inadequate is an ethnic definition of Jewishness. In American Jewry right now, and my beloved brother Steve Cohen may agree with this, since the 1960s, the American Jewish conception of itself has been wildly ethnicized. This has had a positive impact in terms of the sense of belonging in the United States. The United States is a multi-ethnic, we were multicultural before there was multiculturalism. I mean, that is what we are. We are a state of states, and there is that holy American hyphen that gives everybody membership in the United States. The United States being the antithesis of Europe in this respect, not only are you no longer required to erase any of your Jewish difference in America, you're actually rewarded for expressing and demonstrating your Jewish difference. And we have therefore adopted, for the sake of parity with other American Jewish groups, this sort of ethnic definition. This has terrible consequences within the community. It leads to a certain kind of internal relativism in terms of Jewish expressions. An ethnic identity, after all, is primarily an anthropological approach to Jewishness. The problem with an anthropological approach to identity is that every expression of it is equally authentic. So you like Knishes and I like the Mishnah Torah, and together we're Jews. And so so American Jews have come to believe, as I say, that he studies, he likes klezmer, he cooks, and together we make. The fact is, we need a hierarchy of priorities about what Jewish values and which Jewish possessions matter more to us than others, because the disappearance of some would damage us more seriously than the disappearance of others. And not all Jewish expressions, even if they are authentic, are equally valuable. They're not equally valuable. All right. So as I say, in all my wrestlings with all this, I've come to certain conclusions about the religious dimension, the political dimension, the ethnic dimension. I should add one other thing, which is that it's perfectly clear to me that one of the foundational elements of whatever our identity is Jewish peoplehood. And by Jewish peoplehood, I simply mean the historical fact that the Jews have been a people since their origins, have recognized themselves as a people, and as a people are one of the primary constituent elements of world history. We are a people that has intersected with other peoples, but can never be reduced to other peoples. Sometimes the path of our people converges with the path of other people, sometimes it diverges, but the irreducible nature of Jewish peoplehood seems, so again, peoplehood, ethnicity, religion, politics, and so on. Having said all that, what I want to say is that after decades of wrestling with these definitions, I am now officially sick of wrestling with these definitions. That is to say, it's pretty clear to me that the definition of Jewishness is permanently overdetermined and is permanently ambiguous in the sense that we are and have been many things. We are a people, we are a religion, we are a culture, we are a civilization, we are an ethnic group, and so on. And the attempt to try to prioritize, to hierarchize, if you pardon the ugly word, these characteristics are almost always motivated by ideologies or interests of various kinds. People, certainly in America, would like to define their Jewish identity so as to make their life most comfortable for them. And it seems to me that the conclusion that I come to, at least, is that we are all these things. Each of these attributes can become most salient for individual Jews. What matters to me is not which of the attributes of Jewish identity people choose, but the intensity of their commitment to it and the quality of their commitment to it. because and by quality I mean firstly their knowledgeability, their learning, what they know, what they understand. I mean, there isn't any of the attributes of Jewishness that I defined here that could serve as the defining attribute that doesn't require knowledge. There is no escape from knowledge in any definition of Jewish identity. And no amount of practice, no amount of minhag, no amount of ethnic joy, no amount, you know, none of this will substitute for depth of understanding, for depth of understanding. Now, I don't mean to suggest that we should become a nation of intellectuals. You know, it's our dirty secret is that we're not one, and that we've never been one. But I do think that because of the nature of our tradition does impose a certain intellectual responsibility on all Jews who wish to live significantly as Jews. And so what matters to me, as I say, is not, I'm tired of the endless debates about whether it's a national definition, a religious definition, which religious definition, an ethnic definition, but we're a people, what about a culture, is there a future for secular Jewishness? These are all valuable questions. But, you know, when we use the word identity is itself deceptive because we all have identities in the plural. We have identities in the plural, not just as Jews, but as human beings. And when we use the term identity, we use the singular because we wish to choose one of our identities. We reach into our inventory of identities, and for reasons, for prior reasons, philosophical reasons, sentimental reasons, because we're the children of our parents, because et cetera, we choose to make one more salient than the other, and that is the attribute by which we wish to be most known, and that attribute we call our identity. We do this all the time in many ways, but it's very important to recognize, not just humanly, but Jewishly, that the plurality of our identities or of our possible identities is actually the reality of our situation, psychologically and ideologically. And secondly, that this is, as opposed to the old ideological critique of such an approach, this is actually a richness, not a poverty. That this is actually a richness. That we have so many ways to be Jews. Now, that means we have so many ways to be Jews badly, too. I mean, I'm not suggesting that, you know, that 100 Jewish flowers should bloom and we should go to Shalashutis. There's work to be done. There's work to be done. I mean, so, but I think that because of the complexity and the richness of our history, we have many options. We have many options. And what matters to me, and I'll conclude here, is the intensity with which a Jewish individual adopts one of those options, and the quality with which they express those options. And I much prefer, I prefer a learned, sincere, engaged, existentially committed Jew who chooses this Jewishness over a Jew who, on the basis of some ideological criterion or religious criterion, has decided upon some exclusive definition. Remember, definitions are always exercises in exclusion, always. Not quite an elimination, that seems a little harsh, though we've had experiences with that. But I'm no longer interested in exclusions because, frankly, I worry about the future of our people. And I'm not prepared, as I said, to write off thousands and thousands and thousands of Jews because I have arrived in a way that I can defend upon a single definition of what it is to be Jewish. I think the exercise is futile and probably not productive. That's how I'll begin.
Okay. Very strong opening. As you rejected the definitions issue and definitions quarrel, I wonder what is your perspective about the question which is in the center of this conference, the boundaries of Jewish identity. Who is in, who is out? Do you think there should be any criteria for that? And if so, what should be the criteria?
You can't have a meaningful entity without having boundaries. So that's clear, right? On the other hand, more pain and alienation has been caused by the attempt to define boundaries than in almost any other way. The definition of boundaries raises immediately the question of who defines the boundaries? Who has the authority to? In certain areas of Jewish life, meaning the religious area, it may seem that it's more clear who might define the boundaries, but I think I might even dispute that. Because of this obsession with boundaries, we have what I regard as the single most illegitimate and poisonous institution in Jewish life, and that is the Rabbanut HaRashit, which I hope is abolished tomorrow morning, b'mehera b'yameinu amen sela. Well, maybe they're busy. I don't know. You know, I want to be fair. But I do think that. So you're right. It's a good question. Obviously, there can't be no boundaries. But people who police the boundaries, the truant officers of Jewish life, and there are many of them, after a while, it seems to me counterproductive. The boundaries come to be experienced not always as freely chosen, but something within which the Jewish individual is told that he or she is confined, and he or she better get used to it, because outside the boundaries, all other kinds of Jewishness are inauthentic or illegitimate. So I don't really have an adequate answer to your question. I think for an identity to be meaningful, it must be clear, insofar as it can be, which means it must have boundaries. But again, the boundaries should be arrived at slowly, experimentally, and mainly on the basis of knowledge and learning. I think that ignorant Jews cannot in any serious, meaningful way define the boundaries of any kind of Jewishness. And the worst boundary of all, or limitation, is ignorance. I think ignorance is the ignorance of the Jewish religion and ignorance of Jewish history and ignorance of the Hebrew language are the greatest impediments to any meaningful Jewish identity of any kind. And, you know, I've always thought that in order to be a good Jew, you don't just need conviction, you also need competence. You also need competence. That is to say, we have a tradition, it's very long and old, it's very specific to us, it comes in a language that is not English, or French or German or whatever, and it requires real familiarity. I mean, again, we don't all have to be Talmid Chachamim, but et cetera. So I think that, again, I've become more forgiving and more patient about the question. I know Michael doesn't think I have, but I mean, I've become more forgiving and more patient with the question of boundaries. There's a lot of work you can do inside your country before you get to its borders. In other words, a country needs borders, but a country isn't only borders, and you can spend most of your life developing your identity wherever you live and never even see the borders. You just need to know that they're there, I guess.
Well, Yedidia mentioned before the great changes of Jewish history during the last 200 years, secularization and the establishment of the State of Israel. Do you think those changes should impact the issue of Jewish identity and how? For example, maybe the pillars of Jewish identity between should be different between Israel and the Jewish diaspora.
Yeah, I think that there's no question, first, that Israel has to be a central consideration in almost any formulation of Jewish identity, and I can explain why I think that's so. But secondly, I think that there will be differences between Israeli Jewish identity and American Jewish identity, even though both will refer to the same proof texts and the same central realities, such as the State of Israel. You know, we were Bavel and Yerushalayim a very long time ago. And certainly later in the, you know, we created the entirety of our civilization, meaning the Talmud and our post-Talmudic civilization, because our civilization is not biblical, it's Talmudic, right? All of this was created without sovereignty, without political power, without a state. Does that mean we shouldn't have a state? No. But it does mean that there are limitations to that approach, and that we have been essentially a pluralistic civilization for many, many centuries. For many, many centuries, we have had cultures of minhag. Minhag Romania, Minhag Österreich, Minhag Germania, Minhag Bulgaria. I mean, you know, my own view is, I've mentioned the Rabbanut before, it's time for the Orthodox rabbis of America to work up the courage and establish Minhag America. I'm sorry? Minhag America. Because this is the way we have always lived. And not only is this pluralism legitimate, it's been our... I'm sorry?
What? UAHC, CCAR, these are all American.
Yes. Yes, yes. Yes, yes, no, and yes, yes, yes. Yes, but the rabbis I'm talking about don't know that. yes. So I think we have been, you know, de facto, and to a certain extent even de jure, when you look at the place of Minhag in Halacha historically, and the incredible importance and respect that Jewish law has given to local customs and practices. Of course, there's Minhag Shtut, there's Minhag Ta'ut. That's usually not the problem. If they're really stupid or illegitimate, they get taken care of. But generally, they're not. Generally, they originate organically out of Tzorchei HaTzibur. It's what the community needs. And the centrality of the Kehillah, the respect we accord to Minhag, the absence of a Sanhedrin, of any centralized authority. We have not had a centralized authority since the Sanhedrin. We now have a pseudo-Sanhedrin in this city, which is not the same thing. But all that means that we have lived pluralistically. We have lived pluralistically and effectively. It worked for us. It really did. It worked. And you could argue that in Hamburg in 1810, the Minhag were so outside the box. But in fact, that, you know, from an Orthodox standpoint, that's true, and it may be from a larger standpoint, there's some merit to that. But all that means is that we have to maybe extend our understanding of what Minhag is. But I believe that we have been essentially pluralistic. That has been partly our genius, that we've made our tradition portable and flexible, and you know, we can carry it to places and adapt it to things. We have to adapt it in ways that don't destroy the integrity of the system. And we can get into an interesting discussion about what that is, and Michael and I one day will have that interesting discussion. But you can't destroy the integrity of the system. But there's no question in my mind that we have to hang on to our pluralism, because it didn't work for us any other way.
Yeah. Now we'll take one or two questions from the audience. Anyone wants?
Yeah, back there. Yes, they can talk to you, man. You'd say, as if you want three questions. Oh, that's an interesting question.
Okay, gentlemen, we take another question.
Oh, really? Okay.
It seems to me that the problem of the Jewish identity, what is a Jew, it becomes very acute in a Jewish state, where this implies rights that are given to people on the basis of their being Jews or not. And this is very different than being simply a Jew wherever they...
Leon, please.
Okay. I'll start with your question and just comment that it's certainly the case that Jewish identity in a sovereign Jewish state is defined differently than Jewish identity in a state in which Jews are not sovereign, even though questions of rights come up also in the democratic societies in which we live. I don't believe that I think every Jewish community has its characteristic challenges. The Jewish community in Israel has the challenges of a sovereign community that is responsible for the rights of others, I have to add, which is not a responsibility that we have in America, though we are responsible for mutual respect and making coalitions for certain ends, for social justice and so on. But it's not the same thing. It's not the same thing. But I don't believe that the problems of being a Jewish, the problems of Jewishness in a Jewish state are the beginning and the end of the discussion. They're not the beginning and the end. There are particular problems that apply to this. You have burdens that we don't have. We have burdens that you don't have. On the question of non-Jewish definitions of Jewishness, I think it's fair to say that by and large that is has to be and always was significantly external to our understanding of ourselves. That is to say, as a student of Jewish history, I have always been struck by the extent to which the Jewish conception of Judaism, of Jewishness, though Jewishness didn't exist in the Middle Ages as a concept and so on, has been remarkably immune to the experience, to its historical experience. That is to say, you know, if you study, for example, I'll take a medieval example, you look at Ashkenaz after the First Crusade, which was, the First Crusade was, except for something that happened in Spain that we don't know much about earlier, the first attempt to physically exterminate a Jewish community. You know, we now think that it was the beginning of a pattern. They didn't have the pattern yet, right? When before the Second Crusade, when the French Jews, 50 years later, when they warn the German Jews that it's that there's a preacher who's preaching the destruction of the Jews again, we know they got back a letter with the pasuk from Nahum, pa'amayim lo takum tzara. That was the last time a Jew ever wrote those words in that context. The last time, right? But so you look at it after the first, after this huge trauma, and one of the things you discover is that the trauma appears in the invention of Yisker and in the Morbuchin and in the Kaddish, and so, but basically the Jews do not redefine themselves on the basis of their experience of the non-Jews, even. This incredibly traumatic and searing experience. If you look at the Jewish ethical literature in the exile, the Jews were treated very badly in the exile, and yet at no point do I find anywhere the sense that because the non-Jews, the host culture around them, is operating with lower ethical standards, that the Jews can relax and lower their own ethical standards. Non-Jews have always been trying to tell Jews what Jews are, and Jews have always treated that essentially as a political and diplomatic matter. The primary obligation of formulating our self-conception falls on us, and it always did fall on us. It always did fall on us. That was actually not a bad soundtrack to my point, but it really it always has fallen on us. We have. Even in conditions of the worst oppression, we have had the inner freedom that was required to define ourselves according to our own understanding of ourselves. So that's what I would say.
Thank you very much.